riding with my RV.
My RV.
Wherever I want to be. Cause I'm free in my RV.
Greetings from the Miami International Airport. Today we are flying across the pond to London, to be exact, with a short layover at Lisbon.
For a change, our flight is delayed.
So what better way to pass the time
than having a cold one while we wait? I was supposed to get a window seat, but the plane has this kind of gimmicky and fuzzy but way cool displays showing the view from the cockpit. It is almost as good as having a window. It is the first time I see this kind of setup and I like it. It is a good idea to stretch your legs on a long flight like this one. How? Well, by visiting the lavatory. So that's what I'm doing besides, well, you know, we get a pretty good dinner with a choice of fish and pasta and a decent breakfast. And even though it is the most uncomfortable flight I have ever been on, it goes by pretty quickly. In just under 7 hours, we are landing in Lisbon, Portugal.
We are at Lisbon Airport, right here in Portugal. Another country to add to my list.
Our connecting flight is delayed, again, due to a pilot strike. But eventually they take us on this bus to a plane which is parked way back by the runway. And off we go again.
We're leaving.
This time I managed to get a window seat and we get a spectacular view of Lisbon as the plane takes off. As the plane turns, it is almost like the pilot is giving us an aerial tour of the city on purpose. The bridge over the Tajo River estuary does have a striking resemblance to the Golden Gate in San Francisco, and it was actually built by the same company that built the Bay Bridge in that same city. Let's go back, instant replay style, and see all this from my mom's camera point of view. She's sitting a few rows further back. Another seat arrangement screw up. We get fed one more time. It is almost too much food. And we finally land at London Heathrow Airport. We take a black cab to our AirBnB flat in Greenwich. Is that a game of cricket I hear in the background? After over an hour and more than 100 pounds later, we arrive at our flat in Greenwich. The flat is actually quite nice, it's an AirBnB. And the kitchen has everything we need, even an espresso machine. Let me continue showing you around the flat. That's British for apartment, by the way. Now we go out into the neighborhood. Google says there's a supermarket nearby, but to be honest, I think we're lost.
Hello everybody. We have arrived here at London. And well, this is not the most attractive of places. Here we are looking for a supermarket. We were originally going to go to the British Museum, but we had a series of problems getting here, a strike by the airline pilots, etc. So we have arrived here too late to go to the British Museum today, but we'll go tomorrow or the day after. I have no idea where we are. We're looking for a Tesco supermarket to buy some supplies. We went to a Tesco and bought some supplies, and now we're going back to the apartment. And tomorrow, hopefully, we'll be able to see a lot more of the great landmarks this city has to offer.
Don't be misled by the unattractiveness of this little stretch of town here by the Deptford Creek and the railroad tracks. The neighborhood is actually quite lovely. We wish we had more time to explore it. Good morning from Greenwich. Let's head out to London. We walk a short distance towards the river to take the clipper to the city center. Greenwich is actually really, really pretty. Here we stumble upon the Cuddy Sark, one of the last sailing tea clippers ever to be built, before they started using steam for locomotion, or whatever the naval term is. Here's our view from the pier. The tall pyramid is the Shard, the tallest building in the city, and I believe also in all of Western Europe. Right next to the pier, we see the Royal Naval College and the University of Greenwich.
I think our boat is coming.
Off we go, cruising along the Thames River. Here we see Britain's second tallest building at One Canada Square, as we pass by the Canary Wharf Business District. And out in the distance, we see the iconic Tower Bridge. I think this is really efficient of us, taking this clipper. It saves us time. Instead of taking a dedicated river cruise for tourists, we are seeing all the same sights from a mode of public transportation. Pretty cool. After we pass the Tower Bridge, the warship to the right is the HMS Belfast, of Second World War prominence. Yep. As we start going under the Millennium Bridge, we also see the dome of St. Paul's Cathedral. It is such a stereotypical London weather day, overcast and grey. All we need is a little fog. Actually, I've learned that the famous London fog is actually a myth. It was caused by pollution from the coal mine chimneys in the 19th century, so it doesn't happen anymore. We approach Westminster, and it is time for us to get off the boat. We are getting on the London Eye, the giant Ferris wheel next to the Thames River. As we continue gaining altitude, we start enjoying great views of the city from this higher vantage point, the wheel rotating ever so slowly. It takes about half an hour to complete one whole revolution. We see Westminster down there, and let me zoom in on this double-decker bus. We'll see lots of them. We can also see Buckingham Palace, the square in front of it packed with tourists waiting for the changing of the guard ceremony. Our 30-minute ride on this 135-meter-tall Coca-Cola commercial is coming to an end. The serene ride on the London Eye will set you back about £30, yeah, about a pound per minute. It does include a 5-minute-long 4D movie. Whether it's worth it or not, I leave it entirely up to you. I think I would do it once, like today, on my first visit to London. Next time, I'll spend that money on some fish and chips and a London Pride beer, for sure.
Hello everybody, coming to you today from the very heart of London.
We walk across the Westminster Bridge to the north bank of the river, along with the hundreds of other tourists in the area. Here we arrive at Westminster Abbey, the famous Gothic church here in London, and I really wanted to go inside, but the line is over an hour, and they don't even let you take pictures or video inside, so as much as I wanted to see it, forget about it. We will content ourselves contemplating its anticlimactic facade. We continue walking towards Parliament Square with its statue of Mahatma Gandhi. Also, they have a statue of Churchill, and all the tourists are taking pictures. We wanted to continue exploring this area, but we are getting really hungry and a little tired of walking around, so we take an Uber. We are going to eat at a typical fish and chips place, a chippy, as it is also known colloquially. And the Rock and Soil place is one of the oldest in town. It's dating back to 1871. And nowadays it's apparently run by some Nepalese folks, but very, very good food and very friendly service. I recommend it. Since we are in the neighborhood, we walk down to the Covent Garden area. In the center of it all, there is this former fruit and vegetable market. Nowadays, this popular shopping district and restaurants, and it's a touristy site, let's admit it. We continue walking south until we reach the Strand, one of London's main arteries. The road actually dates back to the Roman times, and then it was also used in the Middle Ages. And these zigzagging white lines on London streets are there actually to alert drivers of possible pedestrians crossing the street in the area. Who would have thunk it? We continue towards Trafalgar Square. The area is also very lively and touristy, with street musicians and performers. Right here, in front of the National Portrait Gallery. The name of the square commemorates the Battle of Trafalgar, of the Napoleonic War. At the center here, we have Nelson's Column.
Now coming to you from Trafalgar Square, right here in London. And as you can see behind me, the National Gallery, and we're gonna continue roaming the streets of this great city.
Here also, they usually hold many demonstrations, and most importantly, the New Year's celebrations. We decide to hop on the public transportation, so we go down to the underground to get something called an Oyster card. The Oyster card is a rechargeable card that you can use on the underground and also on the bus system. We take one of the double-decker buses going east on the Strand towards St. Paul's Cathedral.
We are now riding in one of the classic double-decker buses. We have managed to get into one of the real old buses.
We get off by St. Paul's Cathedral. Queen Anne's statue is right in front of it. We make an attempt to go inside, but it is almost 20 pounds and they don't let you film inside either. And to be honest, it doesn't look all that impressive. Maybe I'm wrong. So we decide to keep going. We follow the crowds towards the Millennium Bridge, which is a modern pedestrian-only passage which opened on June of 2000, hence its name, Millennium. There you go. There's the juggler, pretty cool. They also have these people with these carts selling roasted nuts. It seems to be a thing. Here, I'm sure I was saying something profound and inspiring about the bridge, but unfortunately my microphone malfunctioned. Okay, let me try to overdub. Here's St. Paul's Cathedral behind me, and the Thames River, the walkie-talkie, the shard. Well, you get the idea. The bridge was very wobbly when it first opened, so they had to close it down for 2 more years to eliminate the wobble. It finally reopened in 2002. Here we also pass by Shakespeare's Globe. It's a replica of the 1599 Globe Theatre, which was built by the playing company to which Shakespeare belonged. We take another Uber, which by the way, is an outstanding service everywhere we go, seriously. Taking a regular taxi is so 2012. We're going towards the Tower of London, which is not that far, but we want to waste no time. Besides, mother is tired. The Tower of London is this historic castle on the north bank of the river, and it is a major tourist attraction here in London. It houses the crown jewels of England. Many prisoners, including Queen Anne Boleyn, entered through here, the Traitor's Gate. We have some refreshments, taking a quick break here, overlooking the Shard, which is where we intend to end our day today. While we are here, let's walk towards the Tower Bridge. Here we see the London City Hall, this funky looking building, on the other side of the river. And we arrive and go across the bridge. This iconic landmark is a bascule and suspension bridge, and it dates back to the late 19th century. It was an engineering marvel when it was completed. And more roasted nut carts. We take yet another Uber towards the Shard. In order to get to the building, we must go through the London Bridge station. And here we are. Now this place is expensive. It is £25 to get to the top. Really, £25. That is almost $40 US.
Hey everybody, I am coming to you from the Shard, the tallest building in Western Europe. And here we are, ending our day here in London.
To continue my rant about this place and the price, I think out of all the places we have visited here in London so far, this one is quite a ripoff. £25 for just standing around the top floor behind some somewhat dirty glass. Yes, the views are pretty impressive, even on this somewhat grey and hazy day, but I don't think it's worth the $40. Sorry. We take the underground, or the tube, using our newly acquired Oyster card in order to get back to our apartment in Greenwich.
The next station is Bank.
At the Bank station, we switch to the DLR, or the Docklands Light Rail. It's a system of automated trains that goes to this further area where we're staying. As night falls, we approach our destination in East London. At this local pub in Greenwich called the Mitre, and I discovered my new favorite London ale. It is called London Pride. Good morning! Today we continue exploring London. We take the DLR once again and get off at the Canary Wharf station.
The next train at platform one.
The station is actually quite nice with this elliptical glass roof. We are at Canada Square, here in the Canary Wharf, which is a major business district here in London. We walk towards the Tube station. Here we take the Jubilee line towards the Green Park. This is definitely the fastest and most efficient way to travel in the city, but you are underground, so there's no scenery. We get off at the Green Park station and walk along these long passageways to the exit.
There's a light mist coming down.
As the name of the station suggests, we emerge at Green Park. It is one of the royal parks here in London, and is very close to Buckingham Palace, which is, coincidentally, where we're going. All these people seem to be here for the same reason we are, to witness the changing of the guard ceremony. There's really not a whole lot going on, so either we are too early, or what's more likely, late. The band is playing inside though. Let's get a little closer. I don't really know what's going on, but this is kind of dull. Now they stopped playing. Well, we're standing right here next to the gate, so should I ask these two guys what's going on? Maybe not. They have started playing again, and it looks like they are coming out, so let's try to get a good spot. So many tourists are waiting here for this. I really hope it is worth it. But not only did we get here late, we got a horrible viewing spot. Thank goodness for my selfie stick, but still, we're too far away. Yep, that was it. I'm surrounded here by all these disappointed tourists who couldn't see anything. I don't really see what the big deal is. I mean, the band sounds nice, it's a tradition, it's a thing. You know what is a thing? Selfies. Really a thing nowadays.
Hello everybody, and greetings from London. Once again, our second full day here, and I'm standing in front of Buckingham Palace, and we just witnessed, sort of, the changing of the guard. We arrived a little late, and now we're going to continue roaming the streets of this great city and show you lots more. By the way, take a look at all the TV stations back there, because today was the, was it today or yesterday? The birth of the royal baby. Seems to be a big deal around this place. So, see you later.
Here we are going across this great wide avenue called the Mall. It goes from here all the way to Trafalgar Square. We walk along St. James Park, looking for a restroom, or a water closet, or the loo, as they call it here. By the way, brings per change. The loo ain't free. The park is quite beautiful, even on this overcast day. We walk to this street called Pall Mall, which is parallel to the mall, and we take an Uber towards the British Museum. Here we pass by Piccadilly Circus on the way, which is considered London's version of Times Square, but nah, not really. In some ways it kind of reminds me of Puerta del Sol in Madrid for some reason, but nah, it's not that either. I guess it is its own thing. It is basically a meeting place, surrounded by some tourist traps, theaters, restaurants, and a great giant electronic billboard.
We are at the British Museum. Make the line.
This has to be one of the greatest museums in the world. The amount of ancient relics they hold at this place is truly overwhelming. By the way, entrance is free. As we enter, the first thing we see is the Great Court, which is Europe's largest covered square. It is supposedly larger than a football field. We go around the reading room, which is this round structure in the middle, originally a great study hall where many famous people such as Sir Arthur Conan Doyle and even Karl Marx and Lenin did some of their research. Too much research, maybe.
The sun has come out.
We are going to enter the West Wing. This is where all the Egyptian, Assyrian and Greek artifacts are located. As we enter the Egyptian gallery, here's the piece de resistance, the Rosetta Stone, which was discovered in 1799. Without this piece of rock, we may have never been able to translate the ancient Egyptian hieroglyphs. It has the same text in ancient Egyptian at the top, medieval Egyptian in the center, and Greek at the bottom. Since we already knew the bottom two languages, it was relatively easy to decipher the hieroglyphs at the top, the meaning of which were a mystery until this great discovery in 1799, the Rosetta Stone, an ancient version of Google Translate, if you will. We continue towards the right, and here we see this statue of Ramses II. This is the guy who gave Moses a hard time liberating the Hebrew slaves. This was actually just the top of a much larger statue. Next, we go into this area dedicated to Egyptian animals, which they worshipped as incarnations of the gods. This ram here represents the god Amon, protecting a fragile human pharaoh. The cat represents the goddess Bastet, goddess of joy, dance, music, and love, and the protection of pharaohs in battle. Busy goddess. All these boxes made out of stone, that's where they used to put the mummies. This huge granite scarab beetle here at the end of the gallery was a symbol of resurrection and the rising sun. This is apparently because the beetle would go into the ground and then reappear, like the sun rising and setting, like dying and resurrecting. Okay, let's go to the second floor to see actual mummies, along these exquisite Turkish and North African mosaics, which date back to the 2nd century. And here we have it, the painting that inspired the walk like an Egyptian cliché. It is called Nebamum Hunting in the Marshes, from about 1350 BC. The stiff Egyptian look is accomplished by the torso being painted from the front perspective and everything else in profile. I guess they didn't know how to paint any better. We continue walking along all these glass cases displaying all these mummies and coffins and statues, and here we see the X-ray image of the inside of this coffin. That's pretty cool. This man right here is known to scientists as Ginger, or the Gabellene Man. He was 18 to 21 years old when he died, but he wasn't artificially mummified like the rest of the mummies. He was naturally preserved by being buried in the dry sand, with all his organs intact, as well as some of his possessions. Apparently, he died at around 3600 BC. That's 1000 years before the pyramids. Impressive that we can still see his red hair. We see more coffins, burial sites, artifacts, paintings, animal sculptures. We go back down to the main gallery. This long, closed, fisted hand belonged to a colossal statue. And here's the head of that statue with its crown. And more statues as we walk along. The small one stood at the door of a burial place. Now we move into the Assyrian exhibition. These two human-headed winged lions are our welcoming committee. They originally guarded the palace at around 860 BC in what nowadays is Iraq. And now, here we are at the Nimrud Gallery. Here we see examples of the first ever written language, the cuneiform writing, which was invented 5,000 years ago by the Sumerians in southern Mesopotamia, way, way before the Assyrians. We exit the Assyrian gallery along these winged bulls from the Palace of Sargon. Next, we are going into the Greek gallery. Wow! We stand before a Greek temple. This one in particular is called the Nereid Monument from Xanthos, which is, or was, in southwest Turkey. It has all the elements of the standard Greek temple, the pediment, which is the triangle at the top, the frieze that goes all around, and the metopes, which are the relief rock slabs. These statues of exquisite craftsmanship were originally on the temple as well. You can tell special attention was paid to the rendering of the wet clothes. Now we are here at the main hall with all these carved reliefs and statues, which are called the Elgin Marbles. Most of them were made by Greek sculptor Phidias and his assistants. They originally decorated the greatest temple of all, the Parthenon, which still stands at the Acropolis in Athens. Well, what's left of it anyways. First, we have these relief panels, which were part of the frieze. They represent a parade celebrating the birth of the city. All these panels were originally painted in bright colors, and it must have been quite a sight to see them all around the temple. At the far end of this hall, we have the pediment sculptures. They supposedly depict the moment where the city and the goddess Athena were born. The Greek gods lounging at a banquet. Even though the backs of these statues were never meant to be seen, they still show pretty good detail. Steve Jobs would be proud. Finally, the metopes, originally above the columns, many of them depicting humans fighting centaurs. They symbolize the struggle between civilization and barbarism. The things we learn. By the way, curious to know how all this stuff ended up here? Well, this guy, Thomas Bruce, the 7th Earl of Elgin, used somewhat dubious legal grounds and controversial methods and removed half of the Parthenon sculptures and sold them to the British Museum in the early 1800s. A lot of them were later damaged during the cleaning process, and now Greece wants them back. Why wouldn't they? No matter where they belong or where they end up, this cultural treasure belongs to all mankind. The pillars of Western civilization were established during this Greek golden age. We could spend the whole day here, and I could spend the whole day talking about it, but we must go on. The rest of London awaits.
We're leaving, sun is out.
We take another Uber. Does this street look familiar? Of course, it is the Strand. And that's St. Paul's Cathedral up ahead. We got off by the Tower of London and the nearby Tower Bridge. Although we were here yesterday, Today we are going to the Tower Bridge again to see the Tower Bridge exhibition, which will set us back about £14 per person, but it might be worth it. The exhibition begins with this movie about the politics and the design of the bridge. Then we go up to the walkway, which has this really cool glass floor. Beware if you are prone to altitude sickness. Here's Brian making a time lapse with his iPhone. Here we see a great view of the river to the east, and another great view to the west as well. At the end of the exhibition, we see another video showing how the bridge actually works when a tall ship wants to go through. We take an elevator down to the ground level to go see the steam engine that was originally used to operate the bridge. So interesting to see how all this Victorian machinery worked.
The bascule engine. We continue having a wonderful time here on our second full day in London. We just visited the Tower Bridge experience, and that was pretty cool with the glass bottom floor and all that. And now we continue roaming the streets of this wonderful city. And we're gonna try to find something to eat.
We continue and walk past the city hall, this building, and then eat at this pub called the Horniman. I have some kind of meat pie with vegetables and a beer. Pretty good food, slow service. The Horniman is located at this mall called the Hayes Galleria. And off we go. We go down to the tube one more time and get off at St. John's Wood. We are going to visit a must-see place if you are a Beatles fan, Abbey Road Studios.
Hello everybody, we're standing here at the very spot where the Beatles stood in 1967 for the cover of their album, Abbey Road, right here. And everybody's having such a great time taking pictures.
What it looks like on a regular day at one of the most famous sidewalks in the world, Abbey Road.
They have a live webcam at this location. You can check it out at abbeyroad.com/crossing. And here's the video of one of the bloopers from that vantage point.
The long and winding road. I'm standing here at the very spot where the Beatles stood back in 1967 for the cover of the last album. Cuidado, baby! The long...
It is actually amazing that more people don't get run over at this famous crosswalk. Yep, that's us on the bottom right, checking out the studio wall. We hop on the tube one more time We changed trains at Baker Street, where the fictitious character Sherlock Holmes used to live. And this place needs no introduction. The Piccadilly Circus.
Hi everybody, and I think we're going to end our night here in London at this one of the most iconic landmarks the city has, the Piccadilly Circus. See you tomorrow.
Good morning from London. We are on our way to the Victoria Coach Station, where we are going to take a tour of Windsor, Bath and Stonehenge. The tour is offered by Evan Evans Tours, and we booked it through the website Viator. Our first stop is the Windsor Castle. Here we have to make this long line to go in, along with all these other tour groups. We finally pass through the security checkpoint, and here we are. This is the oldest and largest occupied castle in the world. Yes, the Queen still lives here, mainly on weekends. We walk up the castle hill and go through the St. George's Gate and around the Round Tower. Windsor is just 6 miles west of London Heathrow Airport, so the planes are a little bit of a nuisance sometimes. The original moat has been converted into this garden. Here is the Norman Gate, the main entrance to the upper ward of the castle. Here we're going to visit the state apartments, but photography is not allowed inside, unfortunately, so you are going to have to make it all the way here if you want to see it. Here across the courtyard, you have the Royal Apartments, where the Queen actually lives when she's here. The statue on horseback is of King Charles II. And there's another plane flying by, who builds a castle so close to an airport. Wait a minute, it was the other way around, wasn't it? It is really a shame I can't show you the inside of the state apartments, because they are truly magnificent. Even after a fire in 1992 destroyed part of it, it has been fully restored though. We exit through the Norman Gate, where they used to pour hot oil over enemy visitors. It's a good thing we're friendly. And we're going down into the lower ward. Here we encounter the St. George's Chapel, a fine example of Gothic architecture, I hear. A photographer inside is also frowned upon, but I left my camera on inadvertently, so might as well show you whatever footage I got. This chapel is also the final resting place of 10 dead kings, including Henry VIII and his wife, and also Charles I. We walk out into the town of Windsor. And here's one last look at the castle. It seems to be a charming town, but we have absolutely no time to explore. If we don't rush, actually, the tour bus might leave us here and we'll miss the rest of the trip. That's going to be a constant bummer during the whole tour. More than a tour, it is really like an overview of these places, really. Always rushing, always looking at the clock. It is rather stressful. As we approach Bath, the landscape becomes increasingly beautiful, with all these rolling hills. And here we are, arriving in Bath. The bridge to the left over the River Avon is the Pulteney Bridge, one of four bridges in the whole world lined with shops on both sides. And here we are by the circus, a fine example of Georgian architecture, which is British for neoclassical. This structure, as well as the bridge we saw before, date back to the mid-1700s. And if the former was inspired perhaps by Ponte Vecchio in Italy, this one was inspired by the Roman Colosseum, inside out. We continue, and the bus drops us off near the Roman Baths, which we are going to visit next. We wait by this nice square among crowds of tourists, like us. Luckily, we are in front of the majestic Bath Abbey. Officially, the Abbey Church of St. Peter and Paul. It is, I have learned, another great example of perpendicular Gothic architecture. Had we had the time, we would visit it for sure. But it is time to enter the bath, so follow me. This is the site of an ancient Roman bath, built during the Roman occupation of Britain, which lasted until about 400 AD, but most of what you see here dates only back to the 1700s, or even more recent times, built on top of 12th and 16th century structures. By the way, these are the only naturally occurring hot springs in the entire United Kingdom. The name Roman Baths may be a little misleading here, since there is very little authentically Roman in plain sight. Underground is a different story at the museum, and we'll see that soon enough. From the baths, we can see this small square by the side of the abbey. There are always street musicians in these squares. And you know, what I really want to do is come back to this city and just chill here by the square and explore, get lost. But of course, there's no time. Meanwhile, we continue walking around the main pool, among all these Victorian-era sculptures, which honestly, originally I thought were Roman. What do I know? The pool down there, however, is still lined with sheets of lead, actually dating back to the Roman times. Here we get to see the hot spring and the hot mineral water bubbling. Next, we go underground into the museum and we see what's left of the original Roman pediment. And we walk around more ruins of the ancient baths. Don't be impressed by the steam coming out from under our feet. It is artificial. It actually comes out of these nozzles. I'm such a buzzkill. This impressive face belongs to the goddess Minerva. And here's the actual spring, where all the water comes from. And then spills through here, into the great bath. The main pool, as I called it before. Well, it is pretty much time to go. Here we see again the aforementioned Pulteney Bridge over the River Avon. So pretty. Next, we're gonna go to our final and most coveted destination, Stonehenge. These here are reconstructions of the types of huts where the people of this area supposedly lived 5,000 years ago. Look at all these sheep. How cute. Hanging out on the prairie. And here you have it. This bunch of rocks here in the middle of nowhere. Very old rocks. 5,000-year-old rocks. Archaeologists have found evidence that this was originally a burial site, built over the course of about 1,500 years.
We are standing, as you can see here, at Stonehenge in England. It was a beautiful day, but it has started to rain right now. Let me give you a panoramic all around me. There are some sheep back there posing for the pictures. And of course, here it is. This is a great landmark of the prehistory, Stonehenge.
Stonehenge was also apparently an astronomical monument of some sort, although there is no proof of that. A bunch of people gather here on the summer solstice to watch the sunrise, as the stones are aligned with the spot where the sun rises on the longest day of the year. There is also gathering on the sunset on the winter solstice. And here we are, just getting soaking wet. So, off we go.
We're leaving Stonehenge. Till the next time.
By ship, by Stonehenge, we're going back to London. Our day trip here was about $130 per person. Was it worth it? Perhaps. We saw a lot, but it was also very, very rushed. The tour wanted to cover too much in very little time. So it is what it is, an overview. It left us wanting more, so we shall return sometime, with more time. On our last night in London, we ate at an Indian, Bangladeshi, Pakistani place in the famous Brick Lane called Shiba. Probably the culinary highlight of our time in London.
This was fabulous. Mm.
Because it's frustration.
We're almost closing down the place. It's 11 p.m.?
Very good. Shiba. Time to get back to our flat. Under the pouring rain.
The Brick Lane.
So, saying goodbye to Greenwich.
This is the view from our balcony, our last morning here in London. We've barely scratched the surface here in this city, so we must return sometime, hopefully soon. Not only do I want to explore more of London, also our charming neighborhood here in Greenwich. We take another Uber, since we have some time left before we have to leave for the train station. We arrive at Greenwich Park, and here's another great view of London from this higher vantage point. We are going to visit the Royal Observatory of Greenwich.
The Royal Observatory.
We arrive shortly before it opens. Here we have the remaining 10-foot section of what was, in the late 1700s, the largest telescope in the world. 40 feet long, which made it somewhat impractical.
Hi everybody, hello one more time from London. Here I am, straddling the line that divides the east from the west. It's a fictitious line, obviously, but it's been used since they created for navigation and many other things. This is longitude number zero on our planet Earth. And we're coming to you from the Greenwich Observatory, right here in London.
These rooms were originally the residence of John Flamsteed, the first astronomer royal who lived here. Pretty Spartan, if you ask me. Then we walk into this room with all these clocks and measuring instruments, clocks became very important for navigation. It was relatively easy to determine one's latitude at sea by the position of the stars and such, but without accurate time, it was impossible to determine longitude or how far east or west you were. Pendulum clocks did not work well at sea, with all the constant pitching and rolling of the ships, and that is illustrated in this display. The next room is the time and longitude gallery. The following is a collection of the Harrison timekeepers, named H1, H2, and H3, as the design gradually improved so the clock could work at sea. They were all designed by carpenter and clockmaker John Harrison.
Third timepiece.
Eventually, clocks became more accurate, smaller, and even portable. Next, we see an early quartz clock from the 1950s, another quantum leap in accuracy. And finally, today's standard, the atomic clock. There is also a camera obscura, which is a dark room in which the light coming at the top is reflected on a mirror up there and projected on this table underneath. Pretty cool. Time to go up to the Great Equatorial Telescope, the largest of its kind in the UK. Completed in 1893 and retired in the 1960s, it has a rare 28-inch lens that weighs 200 pounds. It is still used for private and usually sold-out viewings in the winter. We go back down to the town, walking along this pretty park, the Greenwich Park. We pass by the Maritime Museum and get this quick glimpse at Nelson's Ship in a Bottle, made by British-Nigerian artist Yinka Shonibare. We continue walking along the streets of Greenwich, wishing we could stay longer, but time is running out. We go down quickly to the Greenwich Foot Tunnel that goes under the Thames. It first opened in 1902, but we don't have time to go all the way to the North Bank.
Doors closing. Ground floor.
We are out of time. In fact, we are running late. We have a train to catch, so promptly we take another Uber. I'm gonna have to get them to sponsor the show if I mention them so much. We are on our way to St. Pancras International train station in order to board the Eurostar to Paris. Unfortunately, we don't make it on time, but fortunately, there is a train every hour, so we are able to board the next one. Well, we are on the way and very excited to visit the City of Light. And the train ride is quite nice. It feels shorter than it actually is. Having wine certainly helps. We go underwater for about 20 minutes and then we are in France. 2.5 hours later, we are in Paris. Yep, the site of Basilique du Sacré-Cœur in Montmartre tells us we are at the right place.
We are in Paris.
We have arrived here at Gare du Nord, or the North Station. It may not look like it, but it is Europe's busiest train station and the busiest in the world outside of Japan. Here we are passing by the Place de la République. Isn't Paris an amazing city? Wait a minute, I think we're about to hit this cyclist in front of us. That was kind of scary, but where did this guy get his license? I'm serious. Yep, we are getting close. We have arrived at our temporary home. Here's the view from our 7th floor apartment, here in Le Marais. My mom's longtime friend and accomplished writer, Madame Machine, has come to visit and she will be our guide tonight. And since she has lived here for so many years, she knows every nook and cranny of this city. We decide to go for a walk around our neighborhood, Le Marais. They have these small markets pretty much at every block. This plug-in electric vehicle belongs to a car sharing service they have here called Autolib. Very, very cool. Man, Paris is great, isn't it? For example, you can see a fountain like this one here, where you least expect it. This is just a regular street. We are now approaching Place de Vosges, the oldest planned square in the city, and it is pretty much the prototype for all these kind of residential squares that are all over Europe.
Hi everybody, we have finally arrived in Paris, and I'm here standing at Place de Vosges.
It was originally named Place Royale by King Henry IV in the early 1600s. Notice how all the facades have the same design. That was one of the architectural innovations of the square. Many prominent historical figures have established residence at Place de Vosges over the years, most notably writer Victor Hugo, famous for Les Misérables and the Hunchback of Notre Dame. And this used to be his apartment. We continue exploring Le Marais, a most historic and aristocratic district. Here we encounter a gas station. Yeah, that is the whole thing. They don't really waste space here with something as mundane as a gas station. As night falls, it is time to eat.
We are at Brasil Beaufranger here in Paris, right next to the Place de la Bastille.
We have some Beaujolais wine, of course, and some bread to get started. I decide to be adventurous and order the foie gras. I have never had it before. Madame Machine orders the oysters, very famous at this place. It is really quite a lovely dining room, with this lively cupola, very elegant. Here's the gratin dauphinois and the sauté beef and my southwestern duck with spring onion hash brown and roasted tomato. So good. And for dessert, well, I have the crème brûlée, what else? It looks like we are closing down the place, so let's go, let's get out of here. I leave you with this view of Place de la Bastille, with the new opera house in the background. Good night.
Bonjour from Paris. I am here in front of the Palais Garnier, the old opera house. And here we begin our first full day at the City of Light.
Yes, we are going to explore this magnificent building in a few. But first, we have an amazing breakfast of café au lait and croissant at this lovely place around the corner called Le Grand Café Capuchin. I think it may be a little late for breakfast or early for lunch because the whole place is pretty much deserted. And here we are in front of the Palais Garnier once again. Check out this guy in the orange sweater. There seems to be something wrong with him. He seems to be talking to himself all the time and it's kind of creepy, but everybody's ignoring him. And maybe we should too. Okay, let's go inside. We have booked the 11 a.m. English tour. Look at the exquisite details on the lamps and the overall architecture. It is quite wonderful. Here's a statue of architect Charles Garnier, the man responsible for all this beauty. Okay, let's go inside. We begin the tour by this sculpture of Pythia, which represents the patron of artists. Right here, under the grand staircase. Pythia, or the Oracle of Delphi, is also a mythological character and god Apollo's priestess. In the late 1800s, those balconies on top would have been full of people, the general public, who would have come through the main door. We, however, are VIPs coming through the side. This is the grand staircase, where we would join the communards who would come through the main entrance behind us. Check out the roof, painted by Isidore Pils, depicting Greek mythological scenes. It is called the Gods of Olympus. Okay, it seems like it is our time to go up the stairs. Here we get a peek at the magnificent five-level auditorium from one of the balconies. And here we get a slightly better view and see the stage, which at the time was one of the largest in the world. and the 7-ton chandelier designed by Garnier himself, and the ceiling painted by Chagall in 1964. It is installed on a removable frame under the original painting. The auditorium is an Italian-styled horseshoe, although some might call it French too because of the decoration. We also visit the Library Museum, where they hold the miniature replicas of the different stage sets. This area was originally intended to be the Emperor's private foyer. Going back the other way, here we have a small-scale replica of the original auditorium ceiling. There's also paintings depicting the history of ballet and models of the building. This room with the infinity mirrors and the bats on the roof is called the Salon of the Moon. Notice the slightly less gold and more silver motif. Okay, I am officially impressed. Take a look at this room. This is the grand foyer. Everything in this room utters opulence, extravagance. It was, in fact, inspired by the Hall of Mirrors in the Versailles Palace. Natural light. We go out to the front balcony to get some fresh air and admire the view. We are treated to this great view of the Place de l'Opéra. From here, I'm going to zoom in through Avenue de l'Opéra into Hotel du Louvre. To the right, Café de la Paix, a famous and fashionable café right here in front of the opera. We are back in the grand foyer, admiring the magnificently decorated ceiling, painted by Paul-Jacques Aimé Baudry. This place is so grand that whatever pictures I can show you don't really do it justice. Here we go into the Salon of the Sun, which has these mosaics on the floor and the infinity mirrors, just like the Salon of the Moon, but with a gold motif. And then this room. Everywhere you look, there is luxury and sumptuousness. This area features Italian mosaics, works of art by Italian artisans, hired by Garnier himself. Here we are back by the grand staircase, this time admiring the view from one of the second floor balconies. Next, we walk into this unfinished area, which was supposed to be Napoleon III's personal entrance. But when he fell from power, the Third Republic did not allow for the area to be finished. Now let's go back into the auditorium one more time. What a magnificent place this is. Here we see the orchestra pit as well, and the horseshoe-shaped auditorium.
But we don't sell the 2013 because of course there are several places.
Each color in the Chagall painting pays tribute to a group of composers and their work. All the greats are represented here: Mozart, Berlioz, Debussy, Ravel, Tchaikovsky, Beethoven. I'm just gonna pretend I'm here to see an opera. Look at the exquisite decorations on this balcony and, well, everywhere else. We are back by the grand staircase, taking one last look, saying goodbye to the great Palais Garnier. Okay, it is time to continue exploring Paris. We go around the building with this requisite human statue here, it's a touristy place after all, and this guy is still talking to himself. He did take off the sweater though. I wonder what's wrong with him, but I guess we'll never find out. let's visit Galerie Lafayette, which is the great department store here in Paris. Not because we want to go shopping or anything like that, but because we actually want to see the building and see the atrium inside with this glass dome and the balconies all around. This is one of the great early department stores, originally founded in 1896 and finished by 1912. From the roof, we get a pretty commanding view of the city, the Eiffel Tower as the centerpiece. Notice how almost all the buildings are at the same height. And here we see the back of the opera. Also, the Golden Dome of Les Invalides. Well, it has started to rain, so let's go underground. First into l'RER and then le métro. They have these fruit stands in the metro as well, pretty cool. We take the underground and get off by the Champs-Élysées. It is our intention to visit l'Arc de Triomphe at the western end of the Champs-Élysées. Emperor Napoleon commissioned it in 1806, and it sits in the middle of Place Charles de Gaulle, which is a traffic circle where 12 avenues converge in the shape of a star. It is nearly impossible to cross the traffic circle. Luckily, they have this underground tunnel. The views from the roof, 50 meters above the street level, are spectacular. Here we are, looking towards Montmartre and the iconic Sacré-Cœur Basilica. And here's Notre Dame and the glass vault of the Grand Palais to the right, and the Louvre Museum in front of us, with the Place de la Concorde obelisk. And below us, the Champs-Élysées.
We are at the top of the Arc de Triomphe. And back there, what you can see is the Champs-Élysées. Paris, a great avenue, and behind it you probably can't see it, but there's the Louvre Museum, and back there, of course, the Lady of Paris, La Tour Eiffel, Eiffel Tower.
Yes, that's a great view of the tower, and you can kind of see Les Invalides too. And now we are looking towards La Défense, the business district, at the center the Grand Arch, completed in 1989 as the 20th century version of l'Arc de Triomphe. We see more rain in the distance, so we might want to go back down. But before we do, let's zoom in one more time on the Sacré-Cœur and on the Champs-Élysées, the Place de la Concorde and the Louvre. And one last look at our favorite tower in Paris. We are back at the ground level, walking towards the tomb of the unknown soldier from World War I, where an eternal flame has been burning since 1920. We have lunch at the nearby Pizza Vesuvio and take a quick stroll down the Champs-Élysées, passing by the famous Lido Cabaret. We wish we could stay here longer, maybe walk the whole thing all the way to the Place de la Concorde, but we want to take a break, we're tired. So we go back down to the metro. We're going back to our apartment in Le Marais. We walk along the long and sometimes not so attractive corridors. I think we are beginning to get the hang of the public transportation system here. At this time of the day, it is pretty busy. It must be rush hour. We emerge by our neighborhood on the Boulevard des Fils du Calvaire, and here we encounter the Cirque d'Hiver, the Winter Circus, opened in 1852. Apparently, the structure is still used for exhibitions and shows, and the circus. We really like this neighborhood, by the way. It isn't all that touristy, and that's actually a good thing. We even have a supermarket very nearby. We go back out, taking an Uber this time. Also an outstanding service here in Paris. get off near Ile de la Cité. This is kilometer zero of the French highways and considered the official center of Paris, right here in front of Notre Dame. This is another one of those iconic places in the French capital, the great Gothic Cathedral. And it took a long time to construct, over 180 years in total, from 1163 to 1345. It is a magnificent building. We pass by Place Saint-Michel, which we will visit some other time. And here we are by the Square du Vert Galant, one of the most romantic places here in Paris, located at the western end of Ile de la Cité. It is a popular place for picnics, I hear. Here we are looking back towards Pont Neuf, and ahead towards Pont des Arts as the sun sets. We enjoy the beautiful sunset from Square du Vert Galant. We look back once again towards Pont Neuf. And even though this is not Pont des Arts, lovers and sweethearts have the tradition of placing padlocks wherever they can as a symbol of their everlasting love. Yes, very romantic. Just like this city. We continue walking along the closed Bouquiniste boxes and encounter the Institut de France, this building which houses five French intellectual academies.
Pont des Arts.
By the way, this is a historic moment. Just a couple of weeks after this video was shot, the government removed all these locks from Pont des Arts, apparently to preserve the structural integrity of the bridge, which had become too heavy. We pass by the Louvre on our way to get another Uber home. Good morning from our AirBnB apartment in Paris.
Yep, this is the whole thing. Only two people fitting here.
See the train stations Gare de l'Est and Gare du Nord. You know, I was going to cut some of this out, but Paris is such a beautiful city. I'm gonna leave most of it in. Girl. We continue up the steep, narrow streets of Montmartre, and it looks like this is as high as we can go by car. And here we are.
Greetings once again from Paris. I'm standing here in front of the Basilic of Sacré-Cœur, and we are on top of the hill called Montmartre here in Paris. Right here you can see the view of Paris is spectacular, even though this is sunny, today is a little hazy.
We were here back in 2006, and I remember vividly walking down that street down there with all the touristy shops. This Romano-Byzantine church is actually not that old. Construction began in 1875, and it was finished just before World War I. Let's take in the view one more time as we zoom in on the Centre Pompidou, the Museum of Modern Art. Let's go back in time to 2006, when we were actually able to climb the stairs to the top of the cupola. We go up the steep stairs, and the views, even halfway to the top, are pretty good.
And I'm about to start crawling.
Yep, these stairs are definitely not OSHA approved, but the climb is definitely worth it. We get spectacular, commanding views of the city from the top. Down and down we go. Back in 2015, let's explore the streets of Montmartre a little bit. And normally this is a very touristy area, but we're early, it's about 9 a.m. Let's take advantage of that. Montmartre, or Mount of Martyrs, has been a place of worship since before the Roman Empire. We're walking towards Place du Tertre, a very touristy square where there are all these artists drawing portraits and painting cityscapes, and some of them are extremely talented. It is a reminder of a time at the beginning of the 20th century when this area was the epicenter of the modern art movement. One can almost imagine a penniless Picasso walking around these streets, drawing inspiration from all the surroundings. Let's continue. There's so much more to see in this area. Macaroons. Yum. Check out the golden cupola of Les Invalides from here. I'm kind of obsessed with that building. This is the famous Moulin de la Galette. Dating back to the 17th century, the windmill and the whole area has been painted by the likes of Renoir, Picasso, Van Gogh, Toulouse-Lautrec, and many others. We continue going, fortunately downhill most of the time, wandering around this pretty neighborhood. And look, Les Invalides again! Let's take a break for some coffee.
Pain au chocolat.
If you saw the French movie Amélie, this will look very familiar to you. This is where she used to live and shop. The entrance to her apartment is just around the corner. Let's go down these stairs. Here we encounter the Wall of Love, in which the phrase I love you is spelled in 250 languages. While we are on the subject of love, a little further down we encounter Place Pigalle. This area is full of sex shops and theaters and adult shows, and as you can see, they even have this place called Sexodrome. I wonder what that's all about. And many other places of questionable reputation, maybe, but it looks like it's all very touristy.
Very aptly named.
We continue walking along Boulevard de Clichy, walking along all these strip clubs and souvenir shops. They even have a museum of eroticism. And wherever they have sex, well, my place of birth, Cuba, has to be represented. And I am sure you've heard of this place.
We continue here in Paris, and right now I'm in front of the Moulin Rouge Cabaret, right here in Boulevard de Clichy, and we just came from Pigalle with all the sex shops and all this kind of sexy red light district neighborhood, and then we're gonna continue roaming the streets, walking around Paris, right now, the Moulin Rouge. Look at everybody taking pictures, isn't that? And I'm here with my selfie stick making a fool out of myself. Talk to you guys later.
We go back down to Le Metro to continue exploring. We emerge by Place de la Bourse, right here, in front of Palais Bronguinart, formerly the Stock Exchange, before it became computerized. They seem to be having some kind of flea market today.
Liberté, égalité et fraternité.
We want to check out some of the famous covered passages of Paris. And here we are at one of them, Galerie Vivienne. This is one of many of these glass-covered passages built in Paris during the first half of the 19th century. They are, if you will, the original shopping mall. This one was built in 1823 in a neoclassical Pompeian style, and it's quite agreeable. We have a quick lunch and off we go. Here we are, by Place des Victories, looking for Palais Royal. Instead, we stumble upon the Banque de France, where the money is. This building with the metallic facade, I haven't really figured out what it is, so if you know, please comment below. We are entering the Palais Royal through this side entrance. Here we encounter these curious fountains with these silver balls called the Fountains of Paul Bury. In this area here between the gardens and the palace, which is called Galerie d'Orléans. In the gardens, the older men are playing a traditional French game called pétanque, one of many popular ball games here in Europe. The gardens that once belonged to the king are now a public park. It is a very pleasant afternoon, and Parisians enjoy the park and the outdoors. Okay, it is time for us to continue exploring Paris. And as you can see, the men are still playing with their balls. We take an Uber along Rue de Rivoli. This right here is the luxurious Hotel Le Meurice, another place which was frequently visited by Salvador Dali and many other artists, located right here across the street from the Tuileries Gardens. We pass by Place de la Concorde and get a glimpse of La Madeleine Church. It was in a tunnel similar to this one that Princess Diana got killed back in 1997. We are on our way to the Trocadero Palace to get that quintessential view of the Eiffel Tower. Unfortunately, the whole place is under construction, so it is impossible to get that postcard perfect view we got back in 2006. Actually, let's go back in time, one more time, since I already dusted off the old DV cassette.
Behind me, well,
okay.
The most photographed icon this city has to offer, the Eiffel Tower.
I do understand if you feel compelled to come here at least once to see the tower, but beware. The place is totally overrun with tourists and hustlers trying to sell you souvenirs, and we saw some suspicious characters too, so do keep your belongings safe. Looking back, as you can see, the balcony where you would stand to take the iconic picture is under construction. We still manage to walk around, enjoying the afternoon. Here we see a carousel, very typical of Paris. And here we have the Vedettes de Paris, one of the many companies that give boat tours on the river.
Hey everybody, I am here just underneath the Eiffel Tower, and I think this is it. It's a pretty good angle, don't you think? And I'm sure there's some weird cosmic energy coming down into me now. It seems this is kind of like, sort of like a pyramid. Oh, maybe not. All right, thank you. Talk to you guys later.
Okay, one last flashback, I promise. Back in 2006, we were able to take the ride to the top of the tower, and I thought I would show you some of those views. They have a wax statue of Eiffel and Edison at the top, in what seems to be a replica of Eiffel's office. The views from almost 300 meters above the street level are truly breathtaking. Okay, back to good old 2015, for good this time. We walk along the majestic, ornate buildings of Avenue Charles Fouquet, in the 7th arrondissement. One quick fact about Paris, it is divided into boroughs or arrondissements, and they are numbered in a spiral pattern beginning at the center of the city, and we are in the 7th right now. We have a snack and some wine here at Les Souffrins, and we sit for a while and watch as life goes by in this marvelous city. And we are back underground. Back at our apartment, just for a quick break, and we go back out. And this time we got a very talkative Uber driver.
Opera, Bastille.
Opera, oui.
Vous allez voir tout ça. Là, c'est le pont neuf. Musée de la Monnaie.
We finally arrive at the Bateau-Mouche terminal. This is the original and most popular of the river tours. In fact, Bateau-Mouche has become kind of a generic term for all the river tours as well. It is incredibly crowded, mostly with Japanese tourists. For the last couple of days, the tide has been really high on the Seine, so the second floor is closed, and we will not be able to go past the Pont des Arts because there is not enough clearance for the boat. Kind of a bummer, we will not be seeing Notre Dame from the water this time. We're going east, approaching Pont Alexander III. Since it is almost the beginning of summer, they have all kinds of outdoors activities here by the river. Built at the end of the 19th century, Pont Alexander III is considered by many the most beautiful bridge in Paris and an engineering marvel at the time. There are a handful of these floating structures that house restaurants, bars, and ballrooms. This one is called Rosa Bonheur. And what a view! Here we see some youngsters enjoying the evening by the riverbank. And we get a glimpse of the Palais Bourbon, which houses the National Assembly. Check out all these luxurious riverfront apartments. And there is another boat that you can rent for special occasions. This one is called Concorde Atlantic. Go Going under the Passerelle de Solferino, we see the Musée d'Orsay. Formerly a train station, Gare d'Orsay, nowadays it houses a great collection of impressionist paintings, along many other works of art. Here's another floating restaurant called Le Quai, and the Legion of Honor behind it. Take one last look at Musée d'Orsay. Look how high the water is. That is supposed to be a sidewalk down there. We are approaching the Institut de France and Pont des Arts. And here is where we're going to turn around because of the high tide. Look, the water goes all the way up to the benches. And here we are by the Louvre, looking under the Pont Royal. There's the Egyptian obelisk at Place de la Concorde, a gift from the Egyptian government in the 19th century. And now, for the piece de resistance, we're going to pass by the Eiffel Tower. Yes, the Tour Eiffel. All these Japanese tourists are going crazy with the selfie sticks. We are passing once again under the Alexander III Bridge. Yeah, everybody's going nuts. Here they have a replica of the Statue of Liberty near the Pont de Grenelle.
We are on the Bateau Mouche and this place is packed with people of all parts of the world. As you can see back there, the statue, the Eiffel Tower, sparkling.
That's it. Good night. Bonjour from Paris. It is a brand new day here at Le Marais, and it is our last day in the city. Let's make it count. Let's continue exploring. As in many other cities, there are musicians in the underground, as we've seen. We emerge near Notre Dame by Place Saint-Michel. We are going to walk a little bit in the Quartier Latin, the Latin Quarter. Here we pass by Pont Saint-Michel. Man, I love this city. We walk along the bouquinists setting up shop. Les Parisiens going out for their morning jog. Here we have a look at Rue du Chat qui pêche, the street of the fishing cat, considered the narrowest street in Paris at just under 6 feet. A little further down, we encounter Shakespeare and Company, a historic English bookstore made famous by the movies Before Sunset and Midnight in Paris. We are now by Rue des Écoles, at the site of the famous Sorbonne University. Founded circa 1150, it has been recognized as one of the first universities. We continue, and here we have the Pantheon, which houses the remains of many important French people, and unfortunately it is undergoing some renovation and it's going to be like that for a while. We see Saint-Étienne behind this classic Citroën. I love it. This is one of those iconic antique French cars. As I mentioned before, here's the Saint-Étienne Church, famous for the movie Midnight in Paris. On these stairs is where the protagonist sits down to wait for that antique Peugeot. Instead, we get this cranky street cleaning guy. Our next stop today is the Luxembourg Gardens. Here's the palace where the French Senate meets, the Luxembourg Palace. And here we have all les Parisiens enjoying their beautiful city. Okay, let's go. We see Notre Dame again as we cross the river. The tower to the right is Tour Saint-Jacques. It is what remains of the Church of Saint-Jacques de la Boucherie, which was demolished during the French Revolution. We are back in our neighborhood. And we're going to buy some chocolates at this boutique place called Jacques Genin. They craft some of the city's most exquisite chocolates. It comes at a price, but hey, we thought we'd splurge and indulge and bring some home. Next, we are going to visit two museums here in Paris, namely L'Orangerie, which features Monet's famous water lilies, and then the Louvre. We get off by Place de la Concorde. And here we are, contemplating this masterpiece of Impressionism. The water lilies, or nymphaeas in French. When I was doing my research, I read somewhere that photography was forbidden in here, and as much as I would have hated that, I think maybe it should be. The crowds of people taking selfies and pictures somewhat diminishes the experience. It prevents you from fully enjoying the magic of these works of art. This pair of oval rooms has been the home to these murals since 1927. The museum also has the Jean-Walter and Paul Guillaume collection, with many other works by Renoir, Cézanne, Matisse, and many others. All the way to the neoclassical Picasso. From here, you can see Arc de la Défense, and Arc de Triomphe, and the Champs-Élysées, and Place de la Concorde, all lined up. That's how perfect this city is. Turning around, we see Arc de Triomphe du Carrousel and the Louvre as we look across the Tuileries Gardens. Look at all the people relaxing by the pond. The Tuileries Gardens was originally the site of a tile factory. Then, in 1564, Queen Catherine de' Medici happened to like the place and she built the Tuileries Palace here. Then, in 1664, King Louis XIV told his gardener to re-landscape the place. And voila! Parisians got this beautiful, relaxing park. Here we arrive by Arc de Triomphe du Carrousel. We see more people relaxing in these gardens by the Louvre.
They closed the side door on us, so we're gonna try from the pyramid, see what happens. The carousel.
And here we are by the Louvre, but the museum is closed. Even though it is supposed to be open until 9 p.m. on Wednesdays and Fridays. It turns out the museum is closing early today because of a little known to us but major holiday here called Victory Day. When I checked the website, I didn't see anything about that. But apparently, it wasn't a fine print. A number of circumstances have led to this disappointing moment, this anticlimactic end to our vacation. First, our Airbnb host lost our prepaid tickets, so we couldn't go on Wednesday like we had planned originally. Then this holiday we didn't even know about. This really brings down our whole day. Well, what's left of the day? I was so looking forward to seeing the Louvre, at least the highlights. If there's a lesson to be learned here is to check the local holidays when traveling and don't ever, ever save the best for last. You never know what might happen. Well, we are tired, disappointed, sad, angry. But you know what? Chances are Paris and the Louvre are going to be here for a while, and I'm pretty sure we will return sometime. There is so much more to see in this city. We've barely scratched the surface. And just when we thought nothing else could go wrong, we have also found out that our flight on TAP Portugal has been cancelled due to a pilot strike, and the airline is not even answering the phone. You know what? We're just going to call it a night.
Nous vous informons que ce vol est entièrement non fumeur. Merci de votre attention.
The good news, we managed to get on a British Airways flight.
We're now going to explain the emergency procedures on this British Airways aircraft.
We're going back to Miami with a short layover in London. Check out the view of Paris from the air. we are finally landing at London Heathrow Airport. They say everything happens for a reason, and guess what? I always wanted to fly on a 747 jumbo jet, and now I'm going to get my chance. Say goodbye to the coast of England. Let me tell you, for such a large plane, it's not all that uncomfortable. And the food is okay, and the crew, very pleasant. About 9 hours later, we are flying above the islands of the Bahamas. We see the eastern coast of South Florida in the distance. What you see down there is a Fort Lauderdale beach. We are almost home. And this is Port Everglades and the Fort Lauderdale Airport. Minutes later, we are landing at MIA, Miami International Airport. We are back in the 305. Well, that's all, folks. Do remember to subscribe if you haven't, and if you liked it, well, give me a thumbs up and share with your friends and comment below. I am also on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and even Snapchat, so follow me there too if you will. I am now Traveling Robert in all of the social networks, and you can also visit the blog at travelingrobert.com. Join the mailing list. As always, thank you so much for watching, and see you on the road.
I'm riding. Riding with my RV, wherever I want to be, because I'm free in my RV.